for me to give a talk at this conference. So, well, this is a continuation of Jacob's talk. So, X is an algebraic curve, smooth and complete over FQ, and G is a smooth group scheme over X, which generically is simply connected. And so our object of interest is this bund G, the moduli stack of principal G bundles on X. So as Jacob explained, so the Day's conjecture on Tamagawa's number, or with Peter's correction, Tamagawa's conjecture on Ziegel number, is equivalent to the following counting formula. So, well, we'll return to this in a second. So we consider bund G, and we consider the set of its FQ points, but, well, it's not an abstract set. Each point has a finite group of automorphisms, and when we count, we divide by this group of automorphisms, for which reason this, well, at least has a chance of being well-defined. It's an infinite sum, but it's an absolutely convergent infinite sum. So what we want to show is that this number times, well, a certain power of Q, I'll write what it is. G is the genus dimension of the group. And times, well, I'll X runs through closed points of the curve. And here I'll write the Tamagawa measure of, well, G of OX. So OX is the local ring at this given point of the curve. So when I write TAM, it's slightly different from what Jacob meant. So here I choose the Tamagawa measure at each place individually, but in such a way that, well, it's kind of my Tamagawa measure is integral, and that's why this number pops out. All right, so we want to show that this product is equal to 1. So this is the kind of the formula that we want to prove in this talk. So, yes. So, and again, as Jacob explained, we'll rewrite this in terms of homology of something. So first, we'll use another conjecture of André Weil, namely, so we'll say that this equals the trace of, well, inverse Frobenius on the cohomology of bund G. So it's a somewhat non-standard way of presenting counting. Usually when you count points, it's compactly supported cohomology and the usual Frobenius. Here, I'm taking the dual space of compactly supported cohomology and the inverse Frobenius, but the dual space of compactly supported cohomology is the cohomology but with coefficients in the dualizing sheaf. And this number is exactly the difference between the constant sheaf and the dualizing sheaf. All right, so this is this, and now what is this? You can also, with my normalization of the Tamagawa measures in each local place, you can also rewrite this, and it'll be, well, factor by factor, to be, well, a very similar thing. The trace of the Frobenius inverse on the cohomology, well, let me, GX, it's the fiber of your group scheme at the point X. So we want this to be equal to 1. And so, again, I'll just repeat the last 3 minutes of Jacob's talk. So how do we, imagine proof.
When you take GX, you can take some kind of neural model.
It doesn't matter. So it's any smooth model will do. the validity of the formula is insensitive. So let me just repeat what he said. Let me denote by V global the vector space, which is the cohomology of bound G. So what we want to have, for each point x, some kind of local space. I call it V local sub x. And the relationship between V global and V local should be the following one. So A I want the trace of Frobenius inverse on V global be just the product, convergent product over the closed points of the traces of the Frobenius on these local guys. And B, I want these local guys just to term-wise match with these local guys, match up to inversion, just want to cancel them out. So I want that for each x, the trace of the Frobenius inverse on the local x times trace of the Frobenius inverse on the cohomology of the fiber of the group want to be equal to 1. Now, if you look at formula B, well, you can ask, well, this number is just the inverse of this number. You can ask, it's the cohomology of what? Like, so, and well, if you recall Hopf's theorem, how the cohomology of the group looks like, it's this exterior algebra on something, that this thing should be the symmetric algebra on the same thing. You unwind it, and it tells you who this V local axes are. So this is the cohomology of BG, of the classifying space. So in other words, let me just rewrite A, and this is kind of what's written on Jacob's last blackboard. So want the following product formula. So the trace of the Frobenius inverse the global should be the product of local on well, and sure enough, sorry, I'll write it, cohomology of bound G. The method of proof is not to prove the equality of numbers by establishing a relationship between the vector spaces themselves. We want to relate the cohomology of bound G to, in some sense, tensor product of cohomologies of the classifying spaces in such a way that this preserves the action of the Frobenius. And so this relationship, which we haven't specified yet, will spit out this equality of numbers. So that's the plan. All right, and now we'll take off, and now we'll start doing some pretty wild stuff. All right. The fiber of G at X. So somebody told me that people object to me saying pre-stack. But that's exactly the word which I'll be saying. So I'll use pre-stacks. I'll use elliptic sheaves on pre-stacks. That's not how the paper is being written, but the paper is being written in more ad hoc fashion. But kind of, well, but I find it the optimal way to explain what's going on. So we don't yet have the formalism of elliptic sheaves on the on pre-stacks, but let's ignore that. So let's pretend that we do. So I will say what the pre-stack is. So a pre-stack, Y, is an arbitrary functor from contravariant function from the category of affine schemes to, well, I don't want to say sets, we'll need groupoids. We don't need infinity groupoids here, just groupoids. So schemes opposite to groupoids. Can think sets. So an example of a pre-stack is bund G, or any algebraic variety is a pre-stack, just take HOM into it. All right. So, to an arbitrary pre-stack, so we know that to algebraic variety over FQ, we can attach the category of elliptic, derived category of elliptic sheaves on it. So what this part of pretense that will be happening in my talk, that I'll pretend that we can do the same thing for pre-stacks by the following formula. So to every pre-stack, you can attach this derived category of pre-sheaves on Y. So what is it? So by definition, an object in this category is a compatible family of objects of the corresponding categories on schemes mapping to your pre-stack. So for every affine scheme S with a map to Y, I attach F sub S inside the derived category of elliptic sheaves on S in a way which is compatible with pullbacks. So a compatible family. Now, which pullbacks? For this talk, and related to the fact that I have Frobenius inverse, so you have elliptic sheaves, you can pull back in two different ways. You can star pullback and you can shriek pullback. So in this talk, these are shriek pullbacks. So I warned you, it'll be wild stuff, but it's, well, it's a Russian conference, so I think it's okay. So why am I doing this? Because, well, we'll need a very particular pre-stack, which is not at all an algebraic variety and not an algebraic stack. And that's the guy that will play in the central role for this talk. And this is the guy that will explain the product formula. Namely, so for a curve X, we attach a pre-stack that we call Ron sub X, which was, well, discovered by Zivran and then put to great use by Bellinson and Rinfeld. So here is the definition. So HOM from a test scheme S to run X, well, it's not even a groupoid, it's just a set, and it's the following set. It's the set of all finite non-empty subsets. Of the set HOM from S to the original X. So it's the algebra geometric gadgets that parametrizes finite non-empty collections of points of your target X. So, and again, these guys do not form an algebraic variety in any sense. You're just collapsing equivalence relations that are by which you're not modding out, but which does not produce an algebraic variety. But yet you want to consider it because you want to consider sheaves on it. All right, and again, so the kind of central object for us is the category of, this derived category of elliptic sheaves on run X. So, what can you do with sheaves on pre-stacks? Pardon me? Discrete, set. Well, by its very definition, like a sheaf on a spree stack is something that can consistently pull back to any scheme. If I have a map between pre stacks, by the very definition of the category, I have the functor of shriek pullback from this derived category on the target to the derived category in the source. And then every time you have a functor, you may wonder if it admits a left adjoint. You can try to push forward. It may admit, may not admit. This left adjoint may be defined, only partially defined. So in general, it's a partially defined functor. It's F lower shriek. Partially defined left adjoint. All right. So, and we'll want to apply it in a very particular situation. So namely, we'll take y1 to be run x and y2 to be the point. And I'll denote this functor by cohomology with compact supports on run x. To, well, the category of sheaves on the point, which is the category of vector spaces. So, and that's the principal operation that we'll be using today. All right, so the next definition, specific to the run space, is factorizable sheaves. It's sheaves. Well, I didn't specify which version exactly of sheaves I use. If it were D-modulus, it will be always defined because X is proper. So the next kind of important definition is of factorizable sheaves. So factorization is an addition structure of a sheaf on the run space. Let me say what it is. So let F be an object of run x. A factorization structure is the following datum.
What do you mean of object of
a sheaf? Object of, sorry. Thank you. Suppose you're given two points of the run space. Let me call them x1 underlined and x2 underlined. And by a point, I mean an S point. So for an arbitrary test scheme S, and again, it's an arbitrary finite subcollection of inside home from S to X. And suppose, well, you can do three things. Okay, let's just secretly, it's maps from x1 and x2 are maps from S to run x. Well, you can, according to our definition of pre-sheaves, you can consider the value of your sheaf on S corresponding to the point x1. Let me denote it by f sub x1. Or you can consider on x2. But you can produce yet a third point, namely taking the union. So take the finite set, which is the union of x1 and x2. And now, here's the condition. Suppose x1 and x2 are non-intersecting. What does it mean? Well, you have these finite subcollections. You can consider they're graphs inside S times X. And what you want is that the unions of graphs of one do not intersect the union of graphs of the other, just non-intersecting points. In this case, we want to be given a datum of isomorphism, moreover, which is associative in the kind of in the appropriate sense. So such an additional datum on a sheaf is called the factorization datum. All right, so I want to keep that. All right. So why am I saying all this? It's because these factorizable sheaves lead to this kind of product formulas. So suppose now, well, again, let's resuppose that we are of a finite field. And so let F be a factorizable sheaf on the Rahn space. In this case, you have the following lemma. Well, under suitable convergence conditions, you can consider, on the one hand, well, conditions, and also we'll assume that X is proper. Consider, well, the compactly supported cohomology on the Rahn space of my F, and then I take the trace of Frobenius inverse. Then this will be equal to the product over closed points of traces of local Frobeniuses on, well, this Schrieck fibers of my F at the points. So maybe this is the central part of this talk, and this explains what Jacob said last in his talk, is that factorizable sheaves on the Rahn space are gadgets that lead to product formulas. So if you see some Euler product that makes sense over function fields, chances are this Euler product is given, kind of, if you want uniform expression, it is the trace of the Frobenius on the cohomology of some factorizable sheaf on the Rahn space. So usually, kind of, this factorizable sheaves in the Rahn space are the progenitors of L functions. All right, so we have this formula that we want, and we have this formula. So kind of the strategy of what we're going to do is pretty clear. We'll arrange a factorizable sheaf such that its Schrieck stocks are exactly these guys, and then we'll want to show that, well, the right left-hand sides match up. Just that's in brief where we are going. So, in more detail.
Can you say a couple of words? What does it mean? What convergence will mean in this situation?
Well, first of all, you need the eigenvalues, well, the traces of the Frobenius, well, a priori the analytic numbers, so you want them to be algebraic integers. So, well, it's convergence in C. Well, C, it's an infinite product, it must converge. No, it's convergence in C. So the first thing I want is that, so the eigenvalues of the Frobenius are algebraic integers, so they can put them into C, and then that's the convergence I want. Any. So there should be like in vague conjectures, they should kind of.
This choice doesn't affect the convergence.
No, I need all the conjugates to have, well, the same norm.
Like, that is
Yes.
Maybe you're going to talk about this.
Yes, so again, so this is, so a priori, this is in, so this is infinite dimensional vector space. You have to make sense of trace on it. So therefore, I mean, so there should be absolute convergence also on the left-hand side.
Is there any process of analytic continuation needed? Or is it
no, it should, no, it should be absolute
the
convergence.
Trace is zero on, all, but on almost all.
No. It's convergence. It's you have, it's basically kind of a bunch. So we have arithmetic series converging.
But is there some way to say algebraically that this identity there shouldn't be any unknown?
Well, for that reason, that's exactly where I don't want to go in this talk. Yeah, there isn't any substantial analysis. There isn't any substantial analysis. Again, so what we want to do, we want to bring this formula to this shape. So here is the first step. Suppose C is any commutative algebra in sheaves on X itself. So it's a elliptic sheaf with kind of pointwise multiplication. So in this case, there is a procedure that produces from it something I'll call C sub run X. And this is a factorizable sheaf on the run space. The main condition giving the factorizability, I have to specify who are the Schrieck fibers of this guy at singletons, and the Schrieck fibers of this sheaf at this singleton set equals the, well, the Schrieck fiber of the original sheaf at the corresponding singleton. So we'll apply to the following C. Namely, we'll take C to be the cohomology of this BGX. So if you wish, this is a sheaf on the curve whose Schrieck fiber at any point is the cohomology of the classifying space of the fiber of G at this point. And the, well, multiplication is just the cup product in the cohomology. And so we'll continue, we'll consider this factorization algebra. And by the very definition, if we take F to be that, so the right-hand side here matches the right-hand side here. So therefore, we rewrite the desired formula as follows. So we want the cohomology of bund G to be isomorphic as a vector space with an action of the Frobenius to cohomology on the Riemann space of the factorization algebra obtained by this procedure from just the algebra of the cohomology of the classifying space. So, factorizable sheaf. So, if you have this, you take the trace of the Frobenius, and by taking and using this formula, you prove the desired formula, which is equivalent to the Tamagawa number equal to one formula. So, what I'll explain next. First of all, see here there are no numbers. This is an isomorphism of vector spaces. And so this makes sense now over arbitrary ground field, in particular over C. So what I'll explain next, so this is actually equivalent to the Atiyah-Bott formula for the cohomology of Banji. So the Atiyah-Bott formula was proved over C for, well, constant group schemes, and we'll see that in a second that this exactly produces their formula in that particular case. So we are abandoning the world of the finite field specific to the finite field of Frobenius. So from now on, we will be concerned with just an isomorphism of just vector spaces. So let me say a few words about the Atiyah-Bott formula. So let's go back to this construction that starts from a commutative algebra and constructs a factorizable sheaf, and of which we can then take the cohomology on the Rahn space. So this construction, in fact, well, is it in itself a certain left adjoint? So in this context, if you start with the algebra C, construct the factorizable sheaf, and take its cohomology on the Rahn space. So, well, in general, if you start with an arbitrary factorizable sheaf, the cohomology will be just a vector space. It will not have a structure. However, if you start with a commutative algebra, this cohomology will itself be a commutative algebra. And moreover, you can say, well, you can characterize it by a universal property. Namely, it is such that a map from it to some other commutative algebra, C tilde, is the same as to map the original C, which is a commutative algebra in sheaves on X, to the constant commutative algebra with fiber C tilde sub X. When I say fiber, I always mean the Schwieg fiber. So basically, this construction is the left adjoint to just take an algebra over the point and pull it back. Well, commutative algebra is just, first of all, it's pointwise multiplication. So for each point of the curve, I'm saying that the Schwieg fiber, which is the cohomology of BGX, is an algebra, just the cup product. And then you move it. No, I don't. I want to say something about the Atiyah-Bott isomorphism, and to write a map in one direction, I want a structure. I'm going to use the structure of algebra. So namely, I'll apply it in the following context. C will be this guy. So I want to map in one direction. I want to map this to this. So namely, I want to explain a map in one direction in the Atiyah-Bott formula. It's the same direction as in the original, well, in the Atiyah-Bott construction. So say I want to map this to the cohomology of bond G. Or according to this adjunction that I wrote, basically what you have to do is for every point of the curve, you have to map the cohomology of, well, BG at this point to the cohomology of bond G. But, so what is this map? This map is just pullback. Namely, well, if you fix the point on the curve, bond G maps to BG, just evaluate. You have a torsor on the curve, restricted to the point, you get a torsor over the point. So you have, let me call this map, evaluation at X. So we have this map, and so this map here is this pullback on the cohomology. Not at all. Yeah, so this map in one direction is defined, is always defined. Neither have I used the fact that G is semi-simple and simply connected. So this map in one direction is always defined. It will just fail to be an isomorphism unless G is semi-simple, simply connected. So again, so a map in one direction, namely this direction, is very geometric and easy. And the challenge is to prove that this map is an isomorphism. So the next thing I want to explain is that what it has to do with the original form of the Atiyah-Bott formula. So let me remind you what it said. So the original so it says the following. So again, in this case, our group scheme is constant. And let's recall that you can write canonically the cohomology of BG as a polynomial algebra on certain generators in even cohomological degrees. And the degrees are the exponents. So let me call the vector space spanned by these generators A. So the Atiyah-Bott formula says the following. That the cohomology of bond G is canonically isomorphic to the symmetric algebra on the following vector space. You take this A and multiply it by the homology of the curve. Well, it's not exactly how it's written in the paper, but that's essentially what it amounts to. It is kind of some transgression of classes. So now I claim that this is what this formula amounts to, namely, if you take, in the general context, if you take C to be the algebra, which is the polynomial algebra viewed as a kind of constant commutative algebra on the curve, and if you take cohomology on the Rond space of the corresponding factorizable guy, this will be the symmetric algebra of A times the homology of the curve. So this formula exactly reproduces the Atiyah-Bott. But this is kind of... It is for the moduli stack in this form. If you want cohomology of the coarse moduli space, you have to take this formula and control what happened on the boundary. It becomes much more complicated. So it's much easier statement for the moduli stack. All right, so now we want to prove the Atiyah-Bott formula. And again, it's not something evident. It's a, as you can see, it's local to global. So you want to, again, as Jacob said, you want to assemble the cohomology of bond G from local contributions. And how are you going to do this? Okay, so that's the next and last thing that I will talk about. So what we'll do, we'll assemble the cohomology of bond G from local contributions, but from very different local contributions. And this is where non-abelian Poincaré duality comes in. So we'll now introduce another pre-stack. Namely, this is the affine Grassmannian. So let me say, for this discussion, for simplicity, let me assume that the group has a good reduction. Or otherwise, instead of X, think about an open subset of the curve where the group has a good reduction. It's just a technical remark. So we introduce another gadget called the Affine-Grassmannian. It's a pre-stack. Let me tell you what it is. So it's a pre-stack which will be equipped with a forgetful map to the original run space. Well, I have to tell you what it takes to map a test scheme to it. Well, we said that it projects to the run space, so the first piece of data will be a point of the run space. So it will be X underlined, which is a finite subcollection, finite non-empty subsets of points from in the set home from S to X. Call it. And the next piece of data is called PG. It's a principal G bundle on S times X. And the last piece of data, I call it alpha, it's a trivialization of this bundle on the open subset of the product, which is the complement to the graph, to the union of graphs of these points. So if you think of S being just the spectrum of the field, so this data will be just a finite collection of points of the curve, and I'm trivializing my bundle away from these points. And this is the way to say it, kind of in families. So this is the Affine-Grassmannian. Endowed with a structural projection to the run space. But in addition, it comes equipped with another map. I'll call it pi. To bound G. Namely, you just retain the datum of P sub G. You forget the point of the run space, you forget the trivialization, you just remember the G bundle. So it here comes maybe the main geometric theorem in our paper. It's a contractibility result. And this theorem is valid for an arbitrary connected G. So you don't, for the next result, you don't need G to be either semi-simple or simply connected. It's always true. The theorem says that pi has contractible fibers. So if you think of what the fibers of this map are, so they're the following. It's basically take a G bundle, and the fiber is all the ways to rationally trivialize it. The assertion is that the space of rational trivializations of any G bundle is, well, it's a pre-stack, but it's contractible in the sense that, let me say, homologically contractible, that if you consider its cohomology with compact supports with coefficients of dualizing sheaf in the sense that I defined before, that cohomology, coefficients of dualizing, which is the same as homology, will be equal to the cohomology, to homology of the point. So this kind of result was originally conjectured by Drinfeld, and then and this is kind of the result. All right, so let me see what kind of bearing it has to the Atiyah-Bott formula. So you can reformulate this homological contractibility of the fibers as follows. Maybe I should have said that on any pre-stack Y, there is something that's called the dualizing sheaf on Y, and that is the pullback from, the one-dimensional vector space considered as a sheaf on the point under the structural projection like to the point. Take your one-dimensional vector space, pull it back. That's by definition the dualizing. So this theorem can be reformulated as follows. Take our Schwieg push forward of, well, we call it corollary, of the dualizing sheaf on this Grassmannian. This will be the dualizing of Bungee. All right, so what does this buy us? It buys us the following. Say I want to compute not the cohomology of Bungee, but the homology of Bungee. Say I want this, which is by definition the cohomology with compact supports with coefficients in the dualizing. Using this corollary, I can substitute for the dualizing on Bungee the direct image with compact supports of the dualizing on the Grassmannian. So as a corollary, we obtain the following, that the homology of Bungee is isomorphic to, well, cohomology with compact supports of the direct image with compact supports. Or you can rewrite it as in one step, cohomology with compact supports. Cohomology with compact supports on the Grassmannian of its own dualizing. And now I'll rewrite it one more time. So what I did, I'm looking at this map, I'm looking at the dualizing, and I'm computing the cohomology of the dualizing of the Grassmannian in the following two-step procedure. First push forward, and then push forward to the point. But now I can do it differently. I can push forward not to Bungee, but to the Rand space. I can compute the same thing using a different map. Note that the cohomology with compact supports and the Grassmannian can be also computed as follows. Is the cohomology with compact supports on the Rand space of the direct image under this map P . So it's a different way to compute the cohomology with coefficients of dualizing. And, well, putting it all together, leave it here. So conclude . So let me introduce the following notation. Let me denote by B, direct image under the map P from the Grassmannian to the Rand space. So we conclude that the homology of Bungee is isomorphic to the cohomology with compact supports on the Rand space of this guy B. So that's what we got as a result of this contractibility result. So that's what we have. And now let me repeat what we want. What we want is that. So let me introduce another notation. Let me denote by A. This factorizable sheaf. So what we want is the cohomology of Bungee to be isomorphic to the cohomology on the Rand space of A. So that's what we want. So we wanted cohomology to be expressed in the Rand space. Instead, we got the homology. What do we do? So the cohomology is dual to the homology. So if you want to prove this, you better show that the right-hand sides are dual of each other. And that's the next kind of, well, the second main step in the paper. Where? Yes, so I should have written omega g, and this is the same as lower dot. Cohomology with compact supports in the coefficients, with coefficients in dualizing is the same thing as homology. And again, so this is valid for any g. This is supposed to be valid only when the group is semi-simple, simply connected. And so the next theorem is the following, that when g is connected, so this B is what's called the E2 causal dual of A. B is A2 causal dual of A. So, well, this is something that would be too technical to explain now. So in the world of factorizable sheaves on the Rahn space, there is a notion of causal duality, which is kind of an analog of what's happening for E2 algebras in topology. And if you look at the sheaves themselves, and you have to play a little bit with another technical issue called unitality, non-unitality, translates into the sheaves being actually Verdier dual of each other. And hence, well, taking into account the fact that X is proper, their cohomologies are the dual vector spaces. So this theorem implies the duality between these two as desired. So let me just end by the following comment on this. So this is not an outlandish statement. So let me tell you what kind of fact it follows from in topology. So in topology follows from the following fact. If you consider BG, if you consider the double loop space, it is homotopy equivalent to the affine-Grassmannian. So basically, you have to imitate this isomorphism in the world of algebraic geometry. And this is what is responsible for this theorem. So again, to summarize the story, so we have this contract. No, in this, yes, so here's how you see it. Like, so this will come out connected, whereas the affine-Grassmannian is connected only for, yeah. So again, to reiterate this entire story, so you have this contractibility result, which is always true, which gives you a local to global principle, but it's not quite what you want. What you are actually after is the Verdier dual of that. And this comes as a result of this causal duality statement.
You use the fact that X is a curve to define the Grassmannian, right?
Yeah, so this heavily relies on the fact that X is a curve.
You cannot even define the Grassmannian if X is not.
Well, you could, it would be stupid. I mean, the Grassmannian is a bundle with a generic trivialization. So let's say trivialization away from finitely many points. If you are on the surface, then the bundle which is trivialized away from codimension 2 will be just trivialized. So it's not very interesting.
Simply connected is not really necessary, just more complicated. You have some n function. You have odd formula or the formula which give the internal n function.
Yes.
Did you try with you can really generalize your construction?
No, so I don't know, well, I don't really know how to ask the question. Again, this is true, but the Grassmannian is disconnected, but again, this still holds, but, so I don't know what, so, okay, maybe somebody in the audience knows. I don't know what the analog of the Atiyah-Bott formula is for, in the non-simply connected case. You can write something ad hoc, but I mean, it's not what you want.
I'm sure you told us, but is the RAM space something concrete in the case of an ordinary complex curve?
In the following sense. So, okay, it's a pre-stack. So it's not, as Volodya is saying, it's the values it sends test schemes to sets, no longer groupoids. It's really set-valued thing. So, okay, but it's concrete in the following sense. So actually, I didn't say it this time. You can write it as a direct limit of something very, very comprehensible. Namely, consider the category whose objects are just finite non-empty sets, and maps are surjections. So if you have a surjection from I to J, you can consider X to the I, X to the, call it phi, X to the J, and then you have the corresponding diagonal map. Well, I'm saying, like, have two points, two elements that collapse into one, then you have the diagonal inside X squared. So the Riemann space is the direct limit over this category of just powers of the curve. So you start with one element set, you have the cop, just x, then you have two element sets, you have x times x, but you mod out by the action of this, well, z mod to z, but then you have x times x to x, and you are collapsing pretty nasty diagonals. So this equivalence relation that you're collapsing no longer produces an algebraic variety. It is a Hausdorff space. It's a legit topological space, but it's just not within the ordinary algebraic geometry.
So, Dennis, can I repeat?
Please.
Okay. So, first of all, suppose that X is just any topological space, or maybe any reasonable topological space. Then the Riemann space is just the set of its non-empty finite sets.
Subsets.
Subsets. Not empty finite subsets. Of course, you have to define the topology on this set. But if X is reasonable, at least, then there is only one reasonable way to define the topology. Now, in particular, you can play this game if your topological space is. Let's say the set of complex points of a great variety of this. Now the whole problem is that this topological space that you get is not quite an algebraic variety. When you just consider subsets of order not greater than two. You don't notice this because, in this case, if you consider a subset of order not greater than 2 is the same as a point of the symmetric square. And the symmetric square is a well-defined algebraic variety. But now, if you think of what happens for subsets of order not greater than 3, then you already noticed that it is not quite an algebraic variety, even if X is a fine line. However, this doesn't really matter for most purposes, at least for the purposes considered.
Because you can still manage sheaves on it.
Yes, you don't. Just to talk about sheaves, let's say for a tile topology or for the usual topology, you don't need, to talk about sheaves for the classical topology, you need just topological space. You don't have to be an algebraic. And if you want to consider sheaves in a more expansive sense, for instance, a tile sheaves, in the case where we have a half-trial algebraic field, then it is still true that you don't have it to be an algebraic variety. For instance, you can proceed, as Dennis explained, this of the word B-square.
Yes.
Some people prefer to call it space in the situation when local words are actually sets when they have more atoms. It's less scary.
Could you say something about the relationship between this contractibility theorem and your theorem about contractibility of space rational elasticity?
This is kind of vastly more general case. Okay. That is just a specific. Okay, it's a good question. So, so on the one hand, there's this contractibility result. On the other hand, there's a specific map in one direction. So the way this theorem is proved, well, the isomorphism of this theorem is such that it's compatible with this. Basically, in some sense, this is a local version of that.
Get G without, there's no inductive step. You just get, you take G and you prove it for G directly. Is that correct?
Right. And again, it's very, very different because
I'm just trying to see if there's any relation.
Yeah, so because one local to global principle comes in not for free, but you just, well, you get something local to global already, and then you play with it.
In the case of split group, is not
easier. It is, well, it is much easier. This result is much easier with the split case.
Okay.